Hi, welcome to EdgeZone Civil Service Academy. Today we are starting a new series on UPSC prelims based question discussion. So let us start our first session. First question is related to white shipping. White shipping information refers to exchange of relevant advance information on movement of illegal ships. India and Seychelles recently signed white shipping agreements. So for the first statement, generally by convention we know that white is a symbol of peace and black is the symbol of evil. Okay, actually not black, the darkness is a symbol of evil. Okay, so here white is related to illegal ships, but it sounds wrong, right? So white is actually related to, should be related to legal ships, right? So we can eliminate the first statement. For a second statement, we should be thorough about the current affairs. Okay, Seychelles is an island country in the Indian Ocean near Africa. We know that. So generally the ships are classified into white, gray and black. Here white ships are the commercial ships. Gray is for military vessels and black is for illegal vessels. So first statement is incorrect. India and Seychelles recently signed some memorandum of understanding with respect to white shipping also. So India has signed the white shipping agreement with several countries like USA, Singapore, like that. So the second statement is correct. So answer is 2 only. So next question is regarding Abuja Treaty. Abuja Treaty is related to which of the following organization? First one is BRICS. BRICS, what is BRICS? BRICS, it is the association of 5 countries, 5 major developing countries in the world. What are they? B for Brazil, R for Russia, I for India, China and South Africa. Abuja Treaty is not related to BRICS. What about Brexit? Brexit is the acronym for Britain exit from European Union. Next is African Economic Community and Shanghai Cooperation Organization. African Economic Community is an organization of the 55 member states of African continent, which was established in 1991. So Abuja Treaty is related to African Economic Community. African Economic Community was established on the basis of this Abuja Treaty. Okay. So next important association is African Union. African Union was established in 2002. Its capital or headquarters is located in the capital city of Ethiopia, which is Addis Ababa. Okay. The aim of the African Union is to safeguard the sovereignty and integrity of all the member states of African continent and to promote the international coordination or cooperation within the framework of United Nations. Next is BRICS. BRICS, it is an association of 5 major developing countries in the world. Okay, so they are Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. So it was started in 2009. Annually there will be a summit of BRICS countries in any of these countries. Okay, held in any of these countries. So there is a bank called BRICS Bank. Its actual name is New Development Bank, which has its headquarters in Shanghai. It was constituted as per the Fortaleza Declaration. Fortaleza is a city in the Brazil during the 6th BRICS Summit in 2014. The leaders signed the agreement which established New Development Bank alias BRICS Bank. The Brexit. Britain officially left the European Union, the 28-member bloc. So, Brexit is the resolution by Britain to exit from the European Union. Okay, the European Union, they have the common market. They have the many of the members use the common currency, euro. Okay, next is European Union was established by the Maastricht Treaty. It is very important, Maastricht Treaty of 1992. Okay, it aims for it developed a single internal market within the Europe with a standardized system of law. Next question is regarding the Bodhisattvas. Which of the following describes incorrectly about Bodhisattvas? Option A, it refers to all the persons who had lived with Gautama Buddha in the search of enlightenment. B, it refers to holy persons who had lived on the earth before the Buddha. C, it refers to any person who is on the path towards Buddha but has not attained yet. D, none of the above. So what do you mean by Bodhisattvas? So Bodhisattvas, they are the enlightened one, enlightened being who postponed their own salvation for helping the other living beings. Okay, they are postponing, they are delaying their enlightenment or their own salvation to help other human beings to get enlightened. Bodhisattva is actually an ideal type, not a depiction of any of the historical person like the Buddha. So they are the enlightened one who help the worshippers. Bodhisattvas, there are many Bodhisattvas, like there are the Buddhist text says there is a future Buddha to come on earth. His name is Maitreya. Maitreya is the Buddha of the future. UPSC has asked about Maitreya in UPSC prelims 2018. Another such Bodhisattva whose name is Avalokiteshvara, who appear in the Buddhist art. So the answer is A. Both B and C is the correct answer. Bodhisattva refers to holy persons who had lived on earth before the Buddha. It refers to any person who is on the path towards Buddha but has not attained it. But it does not refer to all the persons who had lived with Gautama Buddha in search of enlightenment. Okay. So this is the UPSC previous year question in 2018. Who is supposed to be the future Buddha in Mahayana Buddhism? It is Maitreya. Okay. Next question. Maitreya is also known as Ajita. Gautama Buddha, we know the some of the basic facts. His birth was in Lumbini. His enlightenment happened in the Bodh Gaya, which is in current Bihar. His first sermon or Dharma Chakra Pravartana happened in Sarnath, which is in the UP. His death happened in Kushinagara. It is his death. Is known as the Maha Parinirvan. So there is an eightfold path which was proposed by Gautama Buddha. What are the eightfold path? Right understanding, right intention, right speech, action, living, effort, attentiveness, and concentration. Okay, he lived, is supposed to be lived between 563 BC to 483 BC for 80 years. So next question, consider the following statements with reference to Marshall Islands. International dateline passes through Marshall Islands. The Marshall Islands are a sprawling chain of volcanic islands and coral atolls in the Pacific Ocean between Hawaii and Philippines. To answer this question, we should be well thorough with the world map where Marshall Islands are located. So let us see. Marshall Islands are located here, okay, in the Pacific Ocean near Philippines. East side of Philippines, there are many small islands. Marshall Islands is also located there. The international dateline does not passes or crosses through the Marshall Islands. You can see it, right? So this is the Marshall Islands. There are many other islands nearby: Kiribati, Fiji, New Caledonia, Tonga, Samoa, Cook Islands, like that. Papua New Guinea is here. Guam, which is a military base of US, right? It was in the news last year because North Korea had planned to launch a rocket towards Guam. There was a controversy. So Marshall Island, the question, first statement seems to be wrong because international dateline does not pass through Marshall Islands. The Marshall Islands are a sprawling chain of volcanic islands. The formation of islands, the various islands in the Pacific Ocean happened by the volcanic activity. We have studied it in geography. Ocean-ocean convergence, right? Then, next question is, which expert committee of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare declared that the fixed dose combinations as irrational? What does it mean by fixed dose combination? Let us see. The options are Rangarajan Committee, Hanumanth Rao, Kokate, Kasturi Rangan. Fixed dose combination is a cocktail of two or more active drug ingredients. There will be a more than one active ingredients or more than one medicines are combined to form a single medicine, so that doctors can refer a single medicine for various diseases. But the problem with the fixed dose combination is, suppose I am having fever and I am getting a tablet for which can be used, which contains the medicines to cure fever and also the headache, but I don't have headache. So the fixed dose combination have many side effects like this. So according to US healthcare provider, almost half of the drugs sold in India in 2014 were FDC, making it the world leader in combination of drugs. So a health ministry expert committee, which was set up in 2014, declared many of the fixed dose combinations as irrational. So it was Chandrakant Kokate, who is the vice chancellor of KLE University, who headed the expert panel, who declared FDC as irrational. Okay, second one, question number 6 is Global Disability Summit. It was organized by, every year UPSC used to ask any of the index, any of the report, who published this report, like that Global Prospectus report, World Economic Outlook report, like that. Here what will be the answer? Global disability. United Nations Economic and Social Council, International Disability Alliance, Institute for Economics and Peace, International Committee of the Red Cross. Here the answer is disability, International Disability Alliance. Global Disability Summit was organized by International Disability Alliance. So about Global Disability Summit, the first Global Disability Summit was held in 2018 in London. Second summit was held in Buenos Aires, which is the capital city of Argentina. Okay, so International Disability Alliance, it was created in 1999. It is the umbrella organization which focus on improving the awareness and rights for the individuals with disabilities all around the world. So next question, which of the following is correct about parthenogenesis? Parthenogenesis. It is a reproductive strategy that involves development of a female gamete without fertilization. B. It is a reproductive strategy that involves three parents to give birth to a baby. Three parent baby. It is a recently discovered chemical process for the production of superconductors that operates at room temperature. And none of the above. So the answer is, it is a reproductive strategy that involves development of a female gamete without fertilization. So a female organism does not need a male partner for the reproduction activity. That's known as parthenogenesis. So it is also known as the virgin birth. Okay. So females of other species have learned how to reproduce without males. It is a self-fertilization called parthenogenesis. It is common in many invertebrates. Okay. But it is rare in the complex creatures. In 2019, a virgin anaconda, green anaconda, had given birth during the winter in a US zoo. So it is the second known case of parthenogenesis in the green anacondas. So these offsprings are usually just the clone of the mother, because there is only a female contribution of DNA. Okay. So it is known as the parthenogenesis. Next question is, with reference to the e-cigarettes, consider the following statements. Option 1, statement 1, they contain nicotine like the traditional cigarettes. They do not fall within the ambit of Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Regulation Act of 2003. Which of the given statements are correct? For e-cigarette, does it contain nicotine? The e-cigarette liquid typically contains nicotine. Of course, it contains nicotine, propylene, glycol, different flavors. A number of metals, including lead, chromium, nickel, and chemicals like formaldehyde, have been found in aerosols of e-cigarettes. The content of nicotine in e-cigarettes is very high. In normal cigarettes, the amount of nicotine in the tobacco, it ranges between 1 to 2 milligram per milliliter, whereas in the aerosols of e-cigarettes, the nicotine content is more than 30 milligram per milliliter. So it is very dangerous. Union Cabinet has approved the prohibition of electronic cigarettes by an ordinance in 2019. So all the forms of electronic nicotine delivery system were banned as per this ordinance. Note the point that the e-cigarettes contain the nicotine and not the tobacco. So that that's why they does not belong within the ambit of the Cigarettes and Other Tobacco Products Act of 2003, which is generally known as the COTPA Act. So answer is, they contain nicotine like the traditional cigarette, and they do not fall within the ambit of COTPA Act. Okay, it is both 1 and 2 for statements are correct. Next statement is, with reference to the Harappan site Dholavira. Dholavira was divided into three parts, unlike other Harappan cities. Large piece of white stone having the inscription of Harappa was found in Dholavira. City of Dholavira was located in the Ran of Kutch region. So we know that in Harappan civilization, usually the cities were divided into two. One is the upper town and the next is the lower town. But in the case of Dholavira, the city was divided into three sections. which is the unique feature of this Dholavira site. The location of Dholavira is near the Rann of Kutch region of Gujarat. So first and second statement are correct. What about the second one? First and third statements are correct. And the second one is the large piece of white stone having the inscription of Harappa was found in Dholavira. In many of the urban sites, we have got different type of seals which contains the inscription, Harappan inscriptions and Harappan script. But they were very small in size. But in Dholavira, we got a big rocks which contains the Harappan inscription. So Dholavira, the location is here in the Gujarat, in the Rann of Kutch region. It is also known as, in locally, it is also known as Kotada Timba. It's an archaeological site at Kadirbait in Bachau Taluk of Kutch district, Gujarat. Its location is in the Tropic of Cancer. Unlike some other Harappan sites, Dholavira was divided into three parts. Normally, the Harappan sites were divided into two parts. West side, it is the citadel or the upper town. And east side, it is the lower town. But Dholavira was divided into three parts. And there, we got many archaeological evidences like big white stone rocks having large inscriptions. That is one of the unique feature of Dholavira. So, all the statements are correct. Question 9. Question 10 is regarding to the temple architecture of India, ancient India. So, with reference to the cultural history of India, consider the following statement. Nagara, Dravida and Vesara are important temple architectures in India. The Sun Temple at Konark is an example of Vesara style of temple architecture. Dashavadara Temple in Deogar is in Uttar Pradesh, is a Panchayatana style temple. Panchayatana style temple. So we know that in the temple architecture, there are three major type of temple architecture. One is Nagara, which was prevalent in the North India, and Dravida was prevalent in the South India. Vesara is the combination of these two, Nagara and Dravida temple architecture. And the Konark Sun Temple is an example of Vesara style of temple architecture, that we will see. So, Shilpa Shastra mentions three main type of temple architecture. One is Nagara, which is the northern style, Dravida or southern style, and Vesara or mixed style. Mixing of both Nagara and Dravida style. This is then a diagram of Nagara style architecture. Here, the Shigara is curvilinear in shape, and for Dravida style, it is pyramidal in shape, right? There are mandapas, there are vehicles, goburam, like that. So, in the case of Nagara, it is prevalent in northern region. It developed regionally, manifesting its own particular qualities. There are regional differences, attributes in the Nagara architecture also. So, its shape is, the ground plan is mostly square shaped. The tower has a shape of curvilinear shape. Okay, the tower is built above the main deity, which is known as Garbhagriha. It has multiple shigaras. There are no gopurams. Gopurams or entrance doors. Water tank may or may not be present here. For example, Dashavadara temple in Deogar, Uttar Pradesh. It is an example for Nagara type of temple architecture. Vishwanatha temple of Gajarao, Lakshman temple of Gajarao, Jagannath temple of Puri. And for Dravida temple architecture, it is prevalent in southern region. It is also square shaped ground plan. Pyramidal tower is there. It is also known as Vimana. For Nagara type of temple architecture, the tower is known as Shigara, which is curvilinear in shape. In Dravida temple architecture, the tower is pyramidical, or it is also known as Vimana. And subsidiary shrines are either incorporated within the main temple tower or located distinctly. It has squared hall. Gobrams are present here, or entrance doors are present here. Water tank is present at the front of temple. Water tank is also one of the major feature. So it has enclosed compound wall. For example, Dashavatara temple of Deoghar. Sorry, the Dashavatara temple is an example for Nagara. For Dravida type of temple architecture, example is Shore temple of Mahabalipuram, Brihadeshwara temple of Tanjavur, Meenakshi temple of Madurai. In the southern region, right? And next is Vesara. Vesara is a mixed temple architecture of Nagara and Dravida. It is more prevalent in Deccan region, Vindhyas and Krishna, between Vindhyas and Krishna region. It has a hybrid style of Dravida and Nagara architecture. It has a complex ground plan. Multiple shrines are present there. It's pyramidical height. It is normally pyramidical. The towers are pyramidical, but height is very less. Gobrins may or may not be present. Water tank also may or may not be present. For example, Badami temple, Durga temple, Aihole, Virupaksha temple of Pattadakal, like that. What do you mean by Garbhagriha? Garbhagriha means womb house. It is a cave-like sanctum, whereas the deity is located. Mandapa is the entrance to the temple. The Shigara or Vimana. So in South India, it is known as Vimana, and North India, it is known as Shigara. They are mountain-like spire of freestanding temple. Shigara has a carving shape, while Vimana has a pyramidal-like structure. The construction of Mandapa was prevalent, started in the reign of Vijayanagara Empire. It was asked in UPSC prelims 2019. So this is Shikara. This flat disc is known as Amalaga, and this point is known as Kalasha. This entrance is known as Mandapa. This is the deity place, which is known as Garbhagriha. Vahana. Usually there is any of the animal located in front of the temple, which is known as the Vahana or the vehicle of the deity inside. Jagadi is the raised platform for sitting and praying. These are the Jagadi. Jagadi is the raised platform. Okay. This is the Sun Temple at Konark. It is also known as the Black Pagoda. Kona means a corner. Arka means the sun. So it is the Sun Temple at Konark. Konark means the corner of sun. It is a sun temple. It was built by Ganga dynasty Narasimha Deva I. It is a perfect blend of Kalinga architecture, not Vesara. It is a perfect blend of Kalinga architecture. It is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It is part of Odisha School of Nagara style of architecture. Okay. It is Nagara style architecture. Odisha regional attributes are there. Next is the Dashavatara temple in Deoghar, Uttar Pradesh. It is an example of Panchayatana style. What do you mean by Panchayatana? Panchayatana is one when the main shrine is surrounded by four subsidiary shrines. This is the main shrine, and main deity is situated here. And there are four subsidiary shrines at the four corners. For Kandariya Mahadeva temple in Kajuraho, Brahmeshwara temple in Bhubaneswar, Lakshmana and Lingaraja temple, all are example for this Panchayatana style. Next question. With reference to the cultural history of India, consider the following statements. The answer for the 10th question is 1 and 3. Because the Sun Temple at Konark is one of the example of Nagara type, Odisha school of Nagara architecture, right? Kalinga. Ganga dynasty, Narasimha Deva I, who built the Sun Konark temple of Sun Temple of Konark. With reference to next question, with reference to golden langur recently in news, consider the following statements. Chakrashila is India's first wildlife sanctuary with golden langur as the primary species. Chakrashila Wildlife Sanctuary. Golden langur is listed under the vulnerable category in IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. So, what's the IUCN status of golden langur? Where is its habitats? These all things we should know to answer this question. So this is the golden langur. It is an old world monkey found in a small region of western Assam and in the neighboring foothills of the Black Mountains of Bhutan. Okay, it is seen in the western Assam. Its IUCN status is endangered. In the question it is said that they are vulnerable, not vulnerable, they are endangered. They are also listed in the appendix 1 of CITES. CITES, the full form of CITES is Convention on International Trade of Endangered Species and the Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act 1972. So Chakrashila Wildlife Sanctuary is situated in the Assam, which is India's first wildlife sanctuary with the golden langur as the primary species. For the first time since it became a law in 2005, the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, otherwise known as MGNREGA, will have non-human beneficiaries, the rare golden langur, in a reserve forest. It was part of the MGNREGA project. The first non-living being, or sorry, non-human beneficiaries. So, the answer is one only. Next question, previous year question, in which of the following states is lion-tailed macaque found in its natural habitat? Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh is not there. It is known as, it is located in the Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu confluences. Lion-tailed macaque, it is also the IUCN status of endangered. Main protected areas is in Karnataka, Kudremukh National Park. In Kerala, Silent Valley, Periyar National Park, Shendurni Sanctuary. And in Tamil Nadu, Kalakkad Sanctuary and Indira Gandhi Sanctuary. Next question. Identify the Congress session based on the following description. The resolution of Purna Swaraj or complete independence was passed in this session. 26 January 1930 was fixed as the first Independence Day, which was pledged to be celebrated every year. It authorized the launch of civil disobedience program. Which session is that? Of course, it is the Lahore session of 1929. In the Lahore session of 1929, the Congress committee passed a resolution declaring Purna Swaraj. They fixed 26 January 1930 as the first Independence Day, which on that day they pledged that it was a crime against a man and God to submit any longer to British rule. And this Congress session also announced the launching of civil obedience movement. Next question is regarding G7 Ocean Plastics Charter. It is a legally binding charter against the plastic pollution in world's ocean. United States, Canada, France, Germany, Britain, Italy and Japan joined the pact. So, G7 Ocean Plastic Charter. The objective of this G7 Ocean Plastic Charter, it is a non-binding charter. It has a commitment, non-voluntary, non-binding commitment to make all plastics reusable, recyclable or recovered by 2030. Which all countries belong to G7? Canada, France, Germany, Britain and Italy and European Union subscribed the G7 summit at Quebec. The United States and Japan did not join the pact. Who were out from the pact? United States and Japan. So second statement is wrong. First statement, it is a legally binding charter. No, it is a non-legal binding charter. So answer is none of the above. Okay. Next question is, which of the leaders given below belongs to the group of responsivist? So in the early 1920s, there was a disintegration among the nationalist ranks in Congress. A debate started among congressmen on what to do during the transition period. One session, they are known as Swarajists, led by C.R. Das and Motilal Nehru and Ajmal Khan, wanted an end to boycott of legislative council. They wanted to participate in the legislative council election so that the nationalists could raise their voices against the British in the councils. They can expose the basic weakness of these assemblies also. Next group is the No Changes. No Changes advocated entry into legislative council. They do not like to enter into legislative councils. The main leaders of No Changes were Vallabhai Patel, Rajendra Prasad, C. Rajagopalachari, and M. A. Ansari. Okay. Then the Responsivist, Madan Mohan Malaviya of Hindu Mahasabha, Lala Lajpat Rai, and N.C. Kelkar offered cooperation to the government so that the so-called Hindu interest might be safeguarded. They accused Motilal Nehru of letting down Hindus, thus being an anti-Hindu, because they accused that he favors cow slaughter and eating beef. That's all for today's session. Thank you very much.